Hello and welcome once again to the Emerald Heart Radio Show. This is our second show, and we gave a little bit of an insight to what Dave Ashworth, my co-host, is all about. But we want to do a little bit of diverting perhaps this week and then come on to the main subject. But last week we touched very slightly, very shortly on the elders and spirit, and a little bit later on in the show perhaps we'd like to talk about that and explain a little bit more about it. Let me just say hello to Dave and bring him in. Hello, Dave.
Hello, Alan. How are you today?
Yeah, I'm fine. As we were saying just before we come on air, it's certainly been a busy week. I'm here in England at home. You're in Amsterdam. The show's going out from Pennsylvania, so we just need somebody perhaps in China or Australia to come in.
And we I'd just like to also thank our producer, Dave, who's done a great job in bringing this together for us. And we didn't really give him a thanks last week, I don't think. But thanks, Dave, for all the hard work. And it's very interesting behind the scenes, isn't it, Alan, putting the radio show together. And last week, we'd not really spoken much about it until 10 minutes before we went live.
That's right.
And so it's kind of flying by the seat of your pants. And our producer, Dave, said, have you got an intro tune, chaps? And we said, no.
That's right.
And within less than a minute, he'd got an intro tune off the internet. And that's what we're using for the time being.
Well, until to be honest.
Yeah.
I mean, to be honest, listening to it as we came in, it was really kind of soothing. It literally took all any kind of tension away from me. So I personally like it, you know, but you know, that's just a small part of it. Now, for anybody who didn't listen last week and thinking, what on earth is Emerald Heart Radio all about? Well, it's about giving an insight to what spirit is all. Well, what spirit is, I suppose, Dave. I suppose that's a good way of saying, because we talk about spirit, but it's like the source, isn't it? The Emerald Heart is like the source where all energy, I suppose, comes from. Would that be a fair thing to say?
Yeah, it'd be a fair thing to say. So when we connect into the source, in fact, if we take that back one step and think about the journey of enlightenment, or the unfolding towards enlightenment that has been taking place very strongly and accelerating all the time since the 1980s, there was a stream of new healing processes that unfolded during that time for different teachers to bring into the world. And when the Emerald Heart came through, the Emerald Heart Light came through in 2005, this was something completely different. It was not so much a healing light, as we mentioned last week. It's a light for evolution of consciousness, so it opens the heart to let's say a way of looking at the heart is like a rose, or in fact similar to the thousand-petaled lotus. And it's like the heart has petals. What the light does is it gently opens the petals of the heart. And once a petal is opened, it never closes again. And this is the process of evolution of consciousness. So you can't go backwards. You can't do devolution. You can only do evolution. And yes. So when you're working with an evolutionary light, each step is opening the heart to another level of consciousness.
Now, going back, probably about 10 years ago now, Anne and I met a guy named Michael Smith. And I always remember what Michael said to me. And, you know, the kind of work that I do and what you did for a long time. I know you don't do so much of the clearings now, but... and I was talking about what's going on the planet. And he said, well, there was a great shake-up in the year 2000, well, actually 2001, where God decided to shake out all the bad energies, the demons, bad energies out of their hiding place, their resting place, bringing them down to earth so they can be banished once and for all. And I thought about that. I mean, you know, the work that that you do, that I do, we certainly come across a lot of these bad negative energies. And I don't know, what do you think about that insight that Michael talked to me about all these those years ago? Does that make some kind of sense?
Oh, it does, Alan. It makes absolute sense, because what we're looking at here is the way universal consciousness accelerates. And if you accelerate anything, the vibrational frequency changes. And as the vibrational frequency changes, it's going to loosen a few things up.
Yeah.
And so it was quite interesting. My journey between 1999 and 2012 was very interesting. I mean, that's a long period of time. It's 13 years.
Yes.
And I have found that there are a lot of 13s in my pathway. and you know, if you recall, everybody was waiting for December 2012 when something big was going to happen. Nobody really knew what it was, but something big was going to happen. Well, I already felt that this happened in 1999. There was such a shift in the vibration of the universe that everything began to accelerate very, very quickly. And I found that not many people could feel that change, and they were all still waiting for this 2012. Anyway, 2012 came and went, and I did a session in London shortly after December 2012. I think it was January this year. I can't quite remember. It was either January or February this year. And as the guidance began to speak through me, it said, okay, everybody, you've all been waiting for this December 2012. What are you waiting for now? And of course, there was silence in the room. What I was trying to get over to people for that 13 years between 1999 and 2012 was, it's already happened, so stop waiting for it. Get on the train, get yourselves moving now, because otherwise you're just going to be on a train that's, you know, so far behind the leading train of the moment that you'll never ever catch up. Now, it's a bit strong to say you'll never catch up, because the universe has a way of awakening those that it needs to awaken to bring them into the vanguard of the leading souls, if you like. So somebody or a certain group of people have got to be leading the way. They're the people that are bringing in the new frequencies, the new lights, the new healing systems. And that brings me very much to a new healing system we're going to be introducing in the new year. And this has come through one of our elders, which is Lynn Shaw in New York. And Lynn was given this download of the most beautiful, simple system called the Divine Plan. It's absolutely amazing. And Lynn and I have been working on this and testing it out for the last few weeks, and it's going to be ready to launch. In fact, I had an email off only a couple of hours ago to say, Dave, I'm being pushed by the guidance again to start getting ready for teaching this in the new year. So I said, well, once I come back from Amsterdam on Tuesday, we'll get our heads together again and we'll see where we're up to with the whole process. But it's really ready to go, and the guidance is saying, you know, let's move it forward. So to come back to answer that question, in 1999, I felt this massive shift in vibration in the universe, and the universe takes me in and shows me what's happening on a regular basis. And so to answer that question, you know, did God shake everything up so all the demons are shaken out of their hiding place? He's like shaking the spiders out of some old clothes, if you like.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. That's, you know, it, when you're going through the type of acceleration that we're going through at the moment and have been doing since the 90s, since the late 90s, there is no hiding place for things within the illusion. Because what the universe is trying to do is expose everything and strip away that illusion, so all we're left with is truth. And, you know, all the negative or darker forces are going to have nowhere to hide.
Well, when you think about it, Dave, something had got to shift. It could not stay the way that it is. That is probably why there's so many conflicts that's going on across our planet at the moment. Mm-hmm. Because you've got the good energy and the bad energies literally in a battle.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Well, it's always going on. It's you know, we're in the in a world of duality as well as a world of illusion, and yes. And it is light and dark. And sometimes it is a strong and powerful battle, and at other times it's just a case of holding the light there and letting the darker aspects do what they can, but, you know, not applying any force to it. What happens is, you know, I've seen this many, many times with dissolving darker aspects of consciousness out of people. And what happens when you bring the light into people is the subconscious will raise the, it'll work in harmony with the darker aspects, and they'll try and prevent the light from bringing change. Well, you don't have to enter into the battle, even though there is a battle that ensues, because the darker aspects will do everything they can to stop that light moving forward. But if you just hold the light there ever so gently, the dark aspects will try everything they possibly can, and they'll reach a point where there's nothing else to try. And at that moment, that aspect, the darker aspect of consciousness, completely capitulates. It's almost like it just dissolves or dies or explodes, goes inwards, whatever, but there's no force anymore wielding itself against the light.
And the
light will just then bathe through that person, and they'll go through a shift in consciousness.
Do you see that the reason for that is that God's light and powerful energy can overcome any bad forces, even though it at times it can seem as if the bad have the upper hand?
Yeah, I would say absolutely. You know, in any battle, whether it's a forceful battle or a battle without force, the light will always win. And it's almost like it doesn't win. It's the other side that just capitulates or loses, for want of a better description. You know, the whole process of the big game, to give it a title, you know, the big game of separation, moving back towards unity, is all about evolution. It's all about the absorbing more and more light until we carry so much light within us that the dark just can't exist in that reality anymore.
Do you see, Dave, that that this process is about the people who understand or are on the level where they can see, if you want to use the word, the light? It's like a preparation for the next stage in their evolution. In other words, for when they pass from this mortal coil to spirit. Is it like a almost like a passport to what is meant for us?
Yeah. Well, the short answer to that is yes, Alan. A slightly longer answer to that would be that when we incarnate into this reality, we're let's say we have a life plan. It's not always easy to get in touch with that life plan. But I usually find that by the time a person reaches about the age of 38 to 42, it does start to manifest very strongly. So I see from working with the thousands of people I've worked with over the years, you see patterns of how the universe is working within their consciousness. And one of these very strong patterns that I saw in the days as a healer was the first 20 years of life is about being allowed to be a child in the earth. And it's almost like the universe doesn't want you to grow too quickly. It wants you to love the childhood, be the child, explore and experiment, grow your imagination, because the imagination is the key to so many doors. You know, the amazing things I've unfolded on the spiritual path are part down to imagination. And it's a very powerful tool. So the first 20 years... Sorry, Alan, go ahead.
No, that's okay. That actually makes a lot of sense. I mean, I'm just thinking I've got six grandchildren. I'm just thinking to the our youngest one, Zachary, who we look after a couple of times of a week, and he's just three. Yeah. And if any soul had been here before, then it is him. He's so full of fun. The only time that he isn't happy is if he's hungry and he wants something to eat. But all he wants to do is play and laugh. And for a little boy so young, his sense of humour is quite incredible. It's far beyond his years. He'll say something, or he'll listen to you say something, and he'll just laugh and understand what you're saying. So I suppose really, childhood years and then into your teens, really should be about learning, trying to understand, enjoying yourself, and it's so terrible when that is taken away from children by evil, nasty grown-ups, basically. You know, because that is fundamental to life as we know it, continuing and growing.
Mm, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, yeah. So you know, I feel quite sad when you see kids growing up too quickly, and you know, their peers are accelerating and they're trying to keep up with the peers, and they're losing the innocence of childhood. And it's within that innocence that they have such power to grow. But also, by the same token, you know, we're in this amazing technological age, and some of the kids that are so plugged into the universe, it's amazing. You know, I have a friend called Kirk in Manchester, and Kirk runs a photography studio with his partner Ryan. And Ryan's a young lad; he's about 20 years old, and he is so plugged into the universe. It's amazing. I say, Ryan, how do we do this? And it's like the answer is there. It might be a really convoluted and high technical answer, but he just pulled it out of the universe. To see him work is amazing. And if you look at the younger kids, you know, kids around 3 and 4 years old now. In fact, I'm looking for a 5 or 6 year old to teach me how to use my latest mobile phone. Because, I mean, they just pick it up and they're intuitive with it. They're picking up those wavelengths out of the ether. They're coming in already plugged into that high technology. It's almost like they're surfing the web while they're still in the womb. And I find this just fascinating, absolutely fascinating.
Well, you're saying that, and I totally understand what you're saying. There was on the television the other night, and there was actually on about this, about youngsters 2 and 3 years of age, how they can operate iPads, iPhones, you know, all the computers, all the technology.
Yeah, yeah.
But the one thing that it is actually tends to do is isolate that child, that they're more reluctant to interact with their peers because their focus is just on what they're looking at. And what they was actually saying was, you know, as well as it being brilliant that they can operate and these computers, is it taking something away from the childhood? So is that taking something away from a spiritual growth?
Well, the answer to this is very simple. It's all about balance. And, you know, as the adults, we're the guardians and the guiding lights for these children. If we push them away in a corner to play with an iPad or to watch a television set, I mean, before computers and iPads, I've seen so many parents use the TV set as a babysitter. They put the child in front of the TV, and sure, the child is learning many things through the TV set, but what they're not doing is having that human physical interaction. You know, when I was a lad, you know, when Adam was a lad, I'd probably go back as far as Adam. When I was a lad, we lived on the edge of fields that went for miles and miles.
Funny enough, so did I. I did, yeah.
And I was just down there living almost wild in the woods and in the streams and just being in nature from a very young age. And that's where a lot of the sensitivity is developed, because you're bathing yourself within the nature spirit consciousness all the time. Now, when you're sitting in front of a computer, it's not that you're not bathing yourself in some form of consciousness, but, you know, the computer or the iPad or whatever comes through these screens is a fantastic medium for transmitting light, but it also is a fantastic medium for transmitting darkness as well. And unless you're watching the children all the time while you're on that, you've really no idea what they're getting into, unless you've got powerful parental controls on your system. But to come back to the main point, it's about balance. And it's, you know, in the modern world, everybody lives a busy life. And I think what people have really got to do is try and get back into the value of family time together. And just switching everything off and going out and being in nature. And being in nature is for certain going to open up your spiritual connections. By the same token, you know, if part of your life plan, as was mine, and I didn't know about it till I'd had my awakening, if part of your life plan is about awakening in this lifetime and becoming a teacher or a leader in any kind of spiritual field, then there's no way you'll be able to avoid that. The universe will drive you through it. Are you scribbling a note, Alan, or have you gone offline? Well, I think we've lost Alan temporarily, so we'll carry on till he comes
back.
Oh, you're back.
Yeah, it's all right. The connection just went. I don't know what happened there.
I thought you were going to make a cup of tea.
No.
Without just telling me.
It just went dead.
There you go. You mentioned the dark force coming through the universe, coming through the computer, and it just says, here we are. Try this exercise.
That's right, exactly. Oh, dear. Never mind. Anyway. Well, perhaps it's telling us something. They don't like what we're talking about.
Well, we're coming up to a break shortly, aren't we, Alan, in a few minutes' time?
In a couple of minutes, yeah. I think, have you noticed something, Dave? I think what we're trying to get over, we were talking before about perhaps things we're going to talk about, and then we start, and it goes off in a different direction, and I do believe the spirit and the elders, as we started to talk about, they know what they want us to talk about.
Yeah. Well, last time in our first show, we didn't have a plan at all, did we? We just launched into it.
That's right. But you see, the Emerald Art, okay, since you introduced me to the Emerald Art, and we haven't really talked a lot about it, but as I've said to you before privately, I do see the Emerald Art. And I would imagine we all perhaps see it, who do see it, in their own way, their own consciousness. And I see the Emerald Art almost like in the middle. It's like going through, almost like Alice in Wonderland, where you've got the main structure and you're looking into it. And then in there are all the, how can you put it, I don't know what expression to use, the bigwigs, the leaders, the ones that are there to try to enhance us, to lead. It's almost like looking in, and then they're asking you to go in almost to them.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Is that how you see it?
It's very much like that. I mean, I have been taken into the universe in the most amazing ways, and we haven't really got time to go into that before the break, but perhaps after the break we can talk briefly about the elders in spirit and perhaps some of the things I experienced in the process of being taken into the light.
That sounds good. I mean, we're just going to go to the break now. But, I mean, just quickly, if you want to know more about Dave, it's daveashworth.com. You've got that website, haven't you?
That's right. And the blog, which is our up-to-date site, which is where all the events and that are listed, which is emeraldheartlight.com.
And if you want to know more about me, it's calmingthoughts.com. So let's have a break, and we'll be back shortly. Hello there. Yes, welcome back to the Emerald Heart Radio. I'm Alan Cox, and my co-host Dave Ashworth is with me. You were going to carry on from where we left off, Dave, weren't you?
That's right. We were speaking last week about the elders in spirit. You'd become aware of these guides.
Yes.
Over the last 18 months, since about the time we kind of reconnected, I suppose, wasn't it, Alan?
That's right, yes.
Yeah, and in my own experience, I've been taken on journeys into the universe on a few occasions. And one of these occasions, it's always when I've been working with somebody in a very deep level of consciousness, looking very deeply into them, to the point where you can see right through them into the universe. I'll give you an example of that. Many years ago, when I was doing the healing work, probably about 15, 16 years ago, I was working with a client, and I was looking very deeply into the heart. And the guidance kept saying to me, go deeper, go deeper. I can't go any deeper. It's impossible. I just can't get there. And they kept saying, let go, let go. And so I kept breathing deeply and letting go. And I thought, if I let go any more, I will actually die. I'll let go of life. I kind of felt right on that very edge of taking my last breath. Yeah. And then all of a sudden, I shot through the heart of this person and out into the universe. And it was such a mind-expanding process that I couldn't speak for about 3 or 4 days afterwards. And the moment that happened, I realized that this was the macrocosm within the microcosm that the mystics spoke about. It's that moment when you go so deeply into the heart of a person that you touch into a universe within them. And once I hit that universe, it's like I was traveling at the speed of light into this universe. And it's like, well, what an amazing journey. You just don't want to come back. Anyway, you do come back because you're working with a client.
Do you remember You had your workshop studio in near Salford, and we sat on the settee.
I do remember that well.
We just went, didn't we? It was.
Yeah. We sat down. We spoke maybe two or three words, and we were both completely taken out of the body. Yeah. And that's how my healing work worked for many years. The client would come in. We would speak for maybe half an hour, discussing, you know, their issues and life in general and their evolutionary path. And then the guides would say, it's time. And I would put them on the couch, cover them up, and within seconds, we were both completely out of the body, usually for about an hour to an hour and a half. And the work that was done in that time was absolutely phenomenal, and the work was always done on both of us. It was a kind of exchange. It's always an exchange because the process works on the law of balance in exchange, which maybe we'll talk about sometime on the show. That particular day you're referring to was very powerful. And what I understand about those, very clearly about those experiences is that's the moment where the universe brings two people together, where one has a consciousness that's more expanded than the other person. And what they do is connect them in a way that triggers a process of transformation in the second person to bring them up to another level.
That was 1996, that was.
Was it? Yeah.
Yeah.
When was that? Was that in this lifetime?
yes, in this lifetime.
1996.
Yes.
I'm feeling my age now.
No. I've got a year. I'm a year older than you, Dave. So.
Are you really? How old are you?
Me? I'm 63.
I didn't know that. I thought you were younger than me.
No.
You're wearing well.
That's right. Well, you are as well, mate. Self-admiration, joint admiration, this is.
Yeah, that's it, yeah. What's the term for it?
Mutual
admiration society.
That's it. But you see, age is irrelevant, isn't it? Because it's about when somebody is ready to take whatever step is meant for them. And, you know, the person can be, you know, I don't know, 15, 16, 17, 18. You know, the person could even be in the 80s for that matter. It's when it is meant.
That's right, yeah. And it's a mindset. It's as simple as that. You know, you're as young as you really feel. You know, today it was raining a little bit in Amsterdam, and it's a beautiful city, and I was out cycling on along the side of the canals, and, you know, I was going downhill every now and again. You go over a bridge and you go downhill, and I was standing up on the pedals like a teenager with the wind in my face, and I absolutely love it, being on the bike and that sense of freedom. And you know, other friends who cycle here say, you are like a teenager when you're on that bike. And again, it's so wonderful to be able to still get yourself into that sense of a kind of youthful excitement. And, you know, it keeps the heart young. And what we have to be careful of course, is that word balance again. And, you know, having fun, both of us work very hard with light and energy, and we know that this can burn you out, and you have to take a break from it. And this year, the universe has been making me take a large break, and it's been moving me into a new direction. You know, this radio show is part of that new direction, so that I can bring the message in a different way.
Mm. Well, you see, that's it, isn't it? I find that your body, your spirit, tell you, and if your body tells you that you need to break off from this work. And I've been guilty as the next person in not switching off. And in fairness to Anne, you know, at times, you know, she's really been had a go at me, saying, you know, this is nonsense. You know, you get up in the morning, you're working all day long, and then at night time you've got to have times to yourself. And I think sometimes you ignore that fact, but then something happens to you, and basically you have to take notice for a while, don't you?
Yeah, that's right. You do, yeah, because otherwise you will burn out. There's no doubt about it. You know, I've come close to that several times. People don't realise, you know, when you're channeling these powerful energies and this powerful light, it burns the system. It burns the nervous system. And you do have to take great care.
And I think that's a point where perhaps people that come to you for help, and obviously they're in need and they're looking for somebody to help them. And I don't know whether it's they don't realise or they think that what you do is so easy and it isn't an issue, and they can call on you at any time and you can just do what you do. And it isn't quite like that, is it?
No, it's nothing like that at all. You know, I learned very, very early on, you know, people would do exactly that. They'd ring me up any time and just think, hey, that's okay. I can just ring Dave and he'll give me the answers. But they don't realize that that tuning in process can be extremely debilitating after a while. And I had to start to manage my time and energy very, very carefully. And I won't work with anybody without some preliminary email contact first to get an idea of what the issues are, what the case is about. I only really do evolutionary work these days anyway. And I will look at this situation first of all and decide whether I'm the right person for this for the client to work with. And if I am, then I'll take it to another stage and then I'll set up an appointment where we'll have a look in and just review the situation before I then decide whether we're going to do any work.
Do you find that the elders, emerald art, the spirit guidance, have an influence on that?
Well, yes, in fact, they do. I mean, I took a call a couple of weeks ago, and I knew I shouldn't have taken this call. And just because I knew where it would go, it would take us into very deep energetic work, and my energy wasn't strong enough for it at the time. And what they do with me is, if I'm on a call that they don't want me to be on, they'll give me a warning that basically says, Dave, if you're not off this phone in the next 5 minutes, we'll give you a lesson. And what the lesson is, they will drain my energy, every last drop of it, till I almost can't breathe, and they'll do it in about 3 seconds. And so I've learned over the years, the minute I get that warning sign that this is not a case for you, let it go. You know, I help that person, I point them in the right direction, and then I get off the phone as quickly as possible. They give me a little bit of leeway if they can see I'm working towards, you know, passing this person on to somebody who's perhaps more appropriate for them to work with. And of course, you know, with the Emerald Hearts, we very much work as a team of people. So, you know, I've mentioned our elders before. We've got Tim Dyson in London, and we've got Yvonne Herdy in Munich, Lynn Shaw in New York, and Rosa Holtman in Sweden. And it's almost like we have this kind of hierarchy. I've taught them, the light has taught them, they're all moving up into an amazing new level of power and vision and completeness and perfection, for want of better descriptions. They're all mentoring other students, so we have this ongoing mentoring process. And, you know, at any time, even these advanced people can phone me and they can say, Dave, what do you think of this case? And we'll discuss a case between us and, you know, I'll bring the light in from the guidance. I pass it on to them. They pass it to their student. So it's like any person coming into the Emerald Heart is not just dealing with one person, but they're dealing with this amazing hierarchy of very developed and advanced evolutionary spiritual workers.
Have you had word from the Emerald Heart what their ultimate goal is?
Yeah.
Okay.
But I'm not going to talk to it about it on the radio. But
okay, fair enough.
It's stepping. It's too big a picture to speak about, to tell you the truth, Alan. But it's a series of stepping stones, which is leading everybody towards enlightenment. You know, yeah. It's way beyond healing and what I learned in the very early days of the Emerald Heart, working with it and trying to understand it, was that it's this absolutely unlimited and amazing form of consciousness. That's the only way I can describe it.
I was going to say, I can understand why you're not answering the question, because
it's kind of impossible.
Yeah, yeah, and also everybody's journey is different to somebody else's, and we have to find the answer to that ourselves.
We do, yeah. So I think we've got about 10 minutes left, haven't we, Alan?
I believe we have. Yes, something like that.
I just wanted to bring in a little bit about how people can find out what's happening before we end tonight's show.
Yeah.
On our blog website, which is emeraldheartlight.com, that's emeraldheartlight.com, people can find out all about the gatherings and where things are actually happening. So, for example, I'm in Amsterdam this weekend because I'm running a little show, a workshop, and a Being in the Light session where we take people deeply into the light through a very quick meditation. And what they tend to experience is this most amazing peace within a few minutes. And what the peace does is expand the consciousness. It tends to screen out everyday life. It just pushes it all back so you can be there in the moment, in the light, and we can do some work. So that's why I'm in Amsterdam at the moment.
Yeah.
Another couple of important things that people might be interested in on the blog is what we call the guidance of the period. So about every 6 weeks, on average, the universe will take me in to universal consciousness, and it'll show me the patterns of the moment and how those patterns are affecting the consciousness of humanity. And so it's really giving us an opportunity to prepare and ride that wave of consciousness. The universe shows me that it works a bit like the waves on an ocean. You know, waves are constantly moving forward, if you like. They're all crashing on the beach, and the waves are coming in different patterns and different strengths and different sizes, and the troughs between the waves are sometimes wide apart and sometimes closer together. And the universe shows me itself working very much like an ocean. In fact, I wrote a book called Ocean of Emotion about how consciousness works and how we can unfold it. But the guidance of the period, when it takes me in, will show me these patterns and say, this is what's happening right now and for the next few weeks. So if you know what's happening, you know, if it's a period where the universe is going into rest or a calm period, don't try and work too hard because you're not going anywhere. But if the universe is coming into a very energetic phase or an opening phase, then we can align with that. And at the same time I'm given the guidance, I'm also given a vibrational essence that helps to align the consciousness of people with the patterns of the universe as they're unfolding. So basically the universe is saying, this is what's going to happen, Dave, in the next 4 to 6 weeks. Here's an essence which will help people align with that. It'll help pull them into the patterns of the universe. Now, I was given just 2 days ago the next essence of the period. So they'll sometimes give me the essence or sometimes a couple of words, and that's my cue then to sit down at the keyboard. When I sit down at the keyboard, then the universe will give me the whole story. And so it's kind of saying, okay, Dave, it's ready now, ready to download. And the essence of the essence of this coming period is called extreme optimism. And extreme optimism, when I looked into the essence and the guidance, they gave me the first few words for this, and I've got them here on a piece of paper. And it says, extreme optimism, this essence cancels out negative thoughts around not being able to achieve. So it very much cuts through unworthiness, starts to open people's consciousness into a place where they really can achieve. And at the same time as giving me a few words, they also show me images. It's like watching a film sometimes. And they said, what this essence does, it's almost like it opens the chest out right down the middle, like a pair of double doors. And as it opens these double doors, it's opening them to the universe or to God, for want of another description. And it's saying, I am wide open to receive every opportunity that you care to pour into my life at this moment in time.
You know,
this,
Dave,
is, yeah.
I'm sorry. No, what I was going to say was, you're on about that with film. And as you know, on my Understanding Spiritual last night, yeah. I had the X-Files creator, Chris yeah. Carter. And what he actually said to me on air was that he never said no to any opportunity. He if an opportunity was there, it was for him to grasp it and to take it to whatever level that he could. And yeah. In a sense, what you're saying is like that philosophy, isn't it? We limit ourselves to what we can do, and if we can overcome that limitation in our mind, then we can achieve whatever it is that we want to achieve. And yeah. and I just wanted to give that an example that there's somebody who isn't into what we're into, Dave, yeah. but he is understood that without even going through this, because obviously at some point, perhaps even in a previous life, he understood that and has carried that through into this life.
That's right. Well, that's how I would see it as well. He's already got that lesson under his belt. And you know, as you say, we are our own limitation. And the path of the Emerald Heart is about dissolving limitation. And, you know, in fact, we were going to start off this evening by speaking about that interview with Chris, weren't we? But
as usual, right.
Spirits guided it a different way.
That's right. And brought it in as an example to what you've been actually talking about, you know.
That's
because,
right,
you know, it is a guy who, as he says, you know, just come from an ordinary background. And through his determination and taking when the opportunities arose and taking them, has led him to be at the top of his profession. And, you know, and that's there for all of us. And it doesn't mean to say you've got to be a film producer, but whatever it is that you do, as long as you do it to the best of your ability and any opportunities there that you take and you grasp, then you can be a success. And success doesn't actually necessarily mean money. It means achieving what you're able to achieve.
Absolutely correct. And I think in our modern world, too many people do equate success with money. And it's a great shame, because in that process, they miss all kinds of aspects of life.
We've got 10 seconds left, according to Dave. So
right.
I think we've got to wrap it up. So,
well, thanks very much, Alan. It's been a great evening again.
I've enjoyed it very much, and I look forward to next Friday. So, and you'll be able to get to bed an hour early next week, if you want.
Yeah.
So, okay, right. Well,
all right.
It's good night to everybody, and we'll see you next week. Bye
for
now.
Good night, everybody. Thanks for listening. Bye. Now it blends in the dream, joining me in the song of the world. We shall never be alone as we think of us in one, joining voices from above in the dream.
sweet joy.